Hey everyone, and welcome to Age of Reason. This is our first show of the year. We took a long break after our last episode. Today is Saturday, February 27th, 2016, and I'm your host, JC. With me today is James, a newcomer. Just before we go into introductions and things like that, I just have a couple of announcements. Well, the first one is if you'd like to, of course, reach us by email, please do so. Please send us your questions or anything you have an issue with, things like that. The documentary I finished last year, I finally found a way to put it into Facebook. So the way you can reach it is if you go to the page, you look under the section About, and you'll see a section called Apps with a big blue button there saying Shop. You'll click on that, and it will give you two options to either buy the DVD or the Blu-ray. I do use the word shop quite loosely because, as I mentioned before, I can't resell it, so I'm just asking people to pay for the shipping fees and a blank disc, literally, not for the content itself. I think that's all I have to say for the announcements. So, James, please introduce yourself.
All right. Hello, everybody out there. I'm James. I'm here in wonderful Japan. I've been here for a rather long time.
What is the long time? Define.
Define long time. I've been here since 2003. I came over here when I was in the military. They put me over here. I had no intention to ever even think about coming over here. And then there's like, told it like, oh, by the way, did they tell you? Like, I get to my command, and the first thing they tell me is like, oh, hey, did they tell you? Like, tell me what? You're going to Japan. Like, what? Like, yeah, we're leaving out in December. Oh, okay, you didn't know? Nobody told me this, but all right, whatever, you know? So there you go.
So what about your kind of views on religion or lack of?
Okay, well, pretty much my personal view on religion is pretty much we're all just bullshit, basically. You know, I was raised as Christian. You know, I grew up in that household. My father, he wasn't. My mother isn't. She still is. And, you know, and I'd basically look within myself when I was around 13 years old. You know, I started looking to myself and started asking questions. Just did my own research. When I was 13, you know, the internet wasn't really a thing. I mean, there was the internet, but nobody really went on it until later on. I think I was maybe around, what was that? It was around 15 or 16 when I got on the internet, you know, first actually being able to go on the internet with the old school dial-up 56K modem. I'm pretty sure most everybody out there remembers those times. And then now we got cell phones that load up a page in like seconds.
Yeah.
Vice, you know, waiting like 5 minutes for a page to load. It was insane. And then
I still remember like how the pictures would load. It would go like line by line.
Yeah. You wait for a picture to load up. You're waiting there for like, you're like, oh man, only got 30 minutes on this. I'd be at a public library and it'd be like, right. Oh, I got like 30 minutes. Oh, I can only look at like two pages.
Yeah.
And you know, but you know, then I just started doing more and more research and, you know, and just started questioning things, and it didn't add up, you know, just like, kind of like saying 2 + 2 = 900. Now, you know, I would say 2 + 2 = 5, but there is an actual, you can actually make it equal 5. There's an equation to make it equal 5. I used to say that until I looked it up and I'm like, you can? Whoa. You know, kind of like a shocker there. But basically it's just, it doesn't, it's, there's no, you know, there's nothing to it. It's all just imaginary. I mean, really, I mean, even looking back in, you know, the Norse religion, their gods, and you know, people laugh about that now, you know, and the, you know, the Greek gods, and so you know, everybody laughs at them now, you know. But I've actually done some research on, like, you know, I started looking more like Norse mythology and stuff like that. It's a lot of really cool stories in there, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So a lot of really good ones in there, you know, a lot of cool ones. You know, so I just look into it, just do some research on it, you know. And I've looked into pretty much like every single religion that there is out there, you know. It's nothing.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. All right, cool. So today on the menu we have a couple of things to do. First we're going to continue with Exodus, and then I want to do an introduction to arguments, and so we're going to look at how to make premises and conclusions. And then finally we'll finish up with some videos. So I actually have 3 videos lined up, but I don't know how many we'll do. It depends on the time. So without wasting any more time, let's jump into Exodus. So the last time we did this, it was Angel and Jim, I think, and they were talking about the plagues. We just started the plagues, and just to quickly refresh where we finished, the last passage was this whole thing about the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he did not listen to them as the Lord had spoken to Moses. So this actually is repeated many, many times in this thing. It's always like Lord hardened his heart, and then the Pharaoh just didn't listen. Well, okay. I always thought, like, is Lord playing some kind of practical joke?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I think, like, you know, kind of be like in our terminology, it'd be just like trolling him.
Yeah,
literally, it's like reading. It's like, wait, you're just trolling him, you know? You're telling them to do one thing when you know it's not going to happen, you know?
Yeah, so that was basically where we finished, and, well, that's really ridiculous, and it will be repeated later on. So, okay, let's go into the newer stuff. So here, only in the land of Goshen. Oh, by the way, I'm not sure how to pronounce certain things, so I'm just reading them as I see. So only in the land of Goshen, where the people of Israel were, was there no hail. Okay, so basically what this says is that everywhere in the world it was hail, except in Israel. Okay, well, you know, it's fine to make that assumption, but where is the evidence for
exactly
this?
You know, how can you sit there and say that? I mean, it's not like you have the internet back then, you know, where you can go, you know, we can go look at the weather report in Syria if we want. Yeah. I mean, kind of guess what it's like there, but you know,
or even Antarctica, right?
You know, or Antarctica or Norway or Sweden or Finland or whatever, you know, we can go look at that now.
Yeah.
But back then, I mean, really, how can you sit there and say that it's only, that's it?
Like,
what?
And I'm pretty sure, obviously, you know, at this time, people outside of Israel were alive, okay? There were other people living in other places, because back then, not so much countries, but places. Okay, I'm pretty sure that they would have recorded that. Okay, like in Spain, it was hail, and in Italy.
Yeah, exactly. There's like, especially like Romans and stuff like that, you know, they kept a lot of records.
Oh, they did,
a lot of records and everything. It would be something.
Yeah, and Egyptians, of course, because this is related to Egypt.
Yeah.
Okay, by this logic, it would also hail in Egypt, but again, there is no record of that.
Exactly. So.
All right, moving on, we have, still talking about the plagues here. So this is the 9th plague. I wonder how much satisfies God, but okay, he just keeps going.
Well, you know, this is like Old Testament stuff, so of course you're going to get a lot of this stuff
That's true.
So.
All right, here it says, then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand towards heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, a darkness to be felt. So Moses stretched out his hand towards heaven, and there was pitch darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days. But all the people of Israel had light where they lived. Hmm. Okay, this to me sounds again like complete magic. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
Non-evidential magic.
Exactly.
So, okay. You say the people of Israel had light. I'd like to know how. I mean, what? Did God somehow create light bulbs?
Exactly.
Like magical stones that would shine in the dark or something like that?
Of course, of course. And of course, going back to that, you know, there of course would be records somewhere else in the world.
Yes.
Of that. You just can't.
That's
you know?
Right, yeah. It just comes back to what we said just earlier. Yeah. All right, moving on. This is still about the plagues. So Moses said, "Thus says the Lord, about midnight I will go out in the midst of Egypt, and every firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh who sits on his throne, even to the firstborn of the slave girl who is behind the handmill, and all the firstborn of the cattle." Man, the cattle are guilty too? Come on.
Yeah, I know, right? Come on now. Okay, fine, whatever. You know, come on. What is this? What's the little doggy done? Yeah. Come on now. The little cat, what has it done? It's done nothing wrong. Yeah. You know?
Poor animals. Poor. There shall be a great cry throughout all the land of Egypt, such as there has never been, nor ever will be again. How do they know?
Yeah.
But not a dog shall growl against any of the people of Israel, either man or beast, that you may know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. Okay. Yeah, I mean, again, this is absolute magic.
Yeah.
Magical explanations, which are not explanations, of course.
Just pulled out of nowhere.
Yeah.
You know?
And again, there would be some record. Okay, every firstborn dies.
Exactly.
That's a major event.
Exactly.
You would probably think that it would be somewhere. Yeah. You know?
Somebody somewhere else in the world would have something written down, especially something this catastrophic, you know?
Yeah,
It's insane.
I mean, it's almost like wiping out an entire generation.
Yeah,
almost.
Because, I mean, like, you know, we have records of, like, the Holocaust happening. You know, we have records of that. That's where a lot of people died.
Yeah, and there are people who deny.
Yeah, of course, but, you know, that you can probably say for another time, because you can go on and on and on. Oh, I mean, looking, especially the flat earthers.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. All right.
And this is gravity.
Moving on, so it actually continues into the thing called the Passover, which is one of the most cruel things out there in the entire Bible, I think. Then they shall take some blood, they're talking about lamb blood, and put it on the two door posts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that night, roast it on the fire. With unleavened bread and bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted. Okay. The reason why they do that is they're marking the houses of the Egyptians, as far as I remember, right?
Yeah.
Okay, if God is all-knowing and he can be everywhere at once, shouldn't he know where they are?
He already know. I could have sworn he would already know exactly who was what. You know, none of you kind of in, you know, marking on your house to sort of indicate it, you know?
Yeah.
Unless you actually don't know.
Yeah.
You know?
And don't exist.
Exactly.
So here we go. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "This is the statute of the Passover. No foreigner shall eat of it, but every slave that is bought for money." So again, going back to slavery, which is absolutely okay here.
Yeah, of course, in the Bible, of course.
"Is bought for money may eat it after you have circumcised him." And that's another contentious thing, obviously. "No foreigner or hired worker may eat of it." So there's two things here, of course, the slavery, again, and the circumcision thing, which I think people by now agree that it's pretty much just genital mutilation and it should not be done.
Yeah, but of course, even if people still get it done, you know?
Yeah.
Because basically what it comes down to is, like, you know, before they kind of, the reason they were doing it, like, oh, you know, is it health benefits and stuff like that. But, you know, that was proven to be, you know, false. But now basically it's like, okay, you know, your father has it, so he wants his child to look exactly like his, you know, so.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with religion.
Anymore, no, it's nothing.
Yeah. Okay, and so the last two things here we have, and the Lord, I lost track a little bit. Okay, so yeah, this is now, they're leaving Egypt, and God turns into a cloud of fire. Isn't that amazing?
I'd like to see that one. I mean, well, okay, I think maybe David Copperfield can pull that one off.
Maybe, yeah. "And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them along the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, that they might travel by day and by night. The pillar of cloud by day and by the pillar of fire by night did not depart from before the people." Okay, well, again, magic, right?
Yes, exactly.
I mean, and it's kind of interesting, actually, because if, let's just assume for a second mm-hmm. this is true, right? So you got a bunch of people and cattle, by the way, because they had to take them too.
Yeah.
So they're walking in the desert.
Yeah.
The cloud is, well, obviously in front of them, very bright, so it probably illuminates the whole area.
Yeah.
Okay, so the Egyptians that live there, they know exactly where they are. I mean, come on,
exactly.
You can't miss it.
It's like might as well hold up a big sign that's a neon sign. Hello, I'm here. Come get me.
That's right. It's just so weird. It doesn't make any logical sense.
It's like, wait, what? It's like, what? What's that big thing over there? Oh, I don't know. Let's not investigate that.
Yeah. Okay, and so the very last thing here, which I didn't really underline anything, but it's a curious thing because it mentions before in Exodus that Moses was not very educated, let's just say. He's not educated. He couldn't, I think he had a speech defect, so he couldn't speak very properly.
Yeah.
Many other issues. So, okay, this is a guy who can't speak very well, and then he goes into a song suddenly. He starts singing. And if you actually check the lyrics, I guess, of the song, it cannot come from a person who, you know, can't speak well. It's too elaborate for that. So it doesn't add up.
You know, especially being somebody that does write music, you know, it doesn't matter. It wouldn't matter what kind it was, you know. It still takes, you know, a lot of brain power and a lot of imagination, you know, to create lyrics to a song in that nature. So I can tell you right now, that's like, if he had all those problems, there's no way.
Yeah. You
know? I mean, it's possible to make something, you know, like I had a little child, you know, like little kid, he's like maybe second grade, he called to me, he's like, ooh, I made my own song, and it's something very, very, very basic. Mm-hmm, you know what? Mm-hmm. It was like Miss Molly, something. I don't remember what it was, but it was just something. It was something really, you know. I was like, okay, that's cool. You know, I told him, I was like, oh, that's cool, man. That's cool.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not gonna be like, oh, that sucks. You know, don't. You know, it's a little kid. You know,
change your career right now.
Yeah. Don't. You know, don't go into singing. No. You know, but yeah, something of that intricacy.
It's just not realistic. I mean, especially when you have lyrics like these. Just listen to that. You have led in your steadfast love the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them by your strength to your holy abode. Okay, this is it just doesn't match up. I mean,
no, that's not the work of somebody that had any problems.
Yeah, this is a work of a priest who later added it in,
probably. Exactly,
or just wrote the whole thing.
Yeah, actually. Exactly. I mean, the Bible's been translated into how many different languages, you know, and so on and so forth. And you know, it's been proven that there's been stuff added in there from the original text. That's a proven fact.
Yes.
So obviously, this is something that was added in there.
Yeah, definitely. All right. Well, that's enough of the Bible for today, and we're doing good on time. Just one thing I actually forgot to talk about. So, of course, right now in America, it's the elections period. And I think today there is today or tomorrow, it's South Carolina, right, for the Democrats.
I think so.
So,
well, of course, you have to check the date of this video.
Yeah.
Because if somebody comes along, it's like later on, like, what are you talking about? Yeah. The election's already been done.
This So I just want to touch upon that and perhaps get your opinion, because I actually made a video on my page and I very clearly endorsed Bernie Sanders.
Yep.
And I just want to make clear to the people that I don't endorse Bernie Sanders because he is Bernie Sanders.
Yeah.
I endorse him because of his ideas
exactly.
and what he's trying to, to achieve, which is, in my opinion, different from the people who support Hillary Clinton, for example.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
the only argument I always hear from them is, well, you know, she's a woman.
Yeah, you should vote for her just because she's a woman.
Yeah.
I'm like, no. I'm like, you know, at first I'm like, at first thoughts, I'm like, well, you know, we would get Bill Clinton back in office. So I'm like, all right, so maybe not all is lost, because you know, when he was president, you know, I mean, the economy was the best it was ever was at that time.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, how, and that guy's the man. I mean, you know, you talk on the phone, eat a pizza, rule the country, and get a blowjob at the same time.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I'm like, well, that guy's awesome, you know. But of course, her policies and stuff like that, I completely disagree with. But of course, Bernie Sanders, you know, I really started looking into him when I hear everybody talking about him. I'm like, okay, let me look into this guy. I look into his policies, and I'm like, wow, I'm like, this guy's the man. I'm like,
yeah.
He's got a lot of really good things, but of course, a lot of people in the U.S. will sit there and call him a communist.
Of course, of course.
You know, because they obviously don't understand the big, huge difference between a communist and a socialist, you know?
But it's difficult to blame the people, because this is the result of a very decade-long propaganda that started, well, even, I think in the 30s it started.
Yeah.
The godless communists, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there is, of course, even evidence that the government back then really did support Hitler in Germany by giving him funds and even equipment sometimes. And they even used him, in fact, to fight the Russians. Because for the Americans at that time, the communists were just the number one enemy. Yeah. So, oh, we can use Hitler to fight.
Yeah.
So,
of course.
And that's how Bush got rich too, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
He was manipulating the Nazi funds in Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
Neutral country.
Yeah.
I always like that. Mm-hmm. So, neutral country, yeah. Really? Well, no. Yeah.
But my biggest fear is if Donald Trump gets elected.
Yes.
That's my biggest fear.
And it could well happen.
It could. I mean, he's doing really good in the polls. I mean, there's quite a few times where maybe Ted Cruz is basically saying the same thing Trump is, just in so many words. But I'll give him credit. He's actually a little more smarter with his words than Donald Trump, even though they're both saying the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, he's been, I guess to say, a little more PC about it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, than Donald Trump. Donald Trump's very...
He's just, like, head-on.
Aggressive, you know, with his thing. But seriously, I mean, if you look at him and you look at Hitler, it's same.
Yeah.
Where they want to, you know, have people like, no, it's not. How can you compare Donald Trump to Hitler?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, well, what do you mean? How can't you?
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
And the other thing, which is kind of interesting for me, if you look, I don't really understand the system so well. And the thing that frustrates me is actually the super delegates, what's called that. And of course, like 98% of them are in Hillary's pocket for the Democrats. And I just think that's really bullshit. I mean,
yeah, exactly. It's not supposed to be, you know, a complete fair election, you know, voted by
zero.
The people, you know, one person, one vote, that's it, you know. That's, no.
Instead, she gets like 500 of them, and that's a huge head start. I mean,
hopefully Bernie Sanders. And big thing, I don't think it's going to happen, though. You know, Bill O'Reilly, you know, from Fox News, this sort of says, oh, you know, if he gets elected, I'm moving to Ireland.
Well, he always says that, though. I mean, he said that, I think, when Obama was elected. It didn't happen.
Exactly. So. It's not going to happen. He's making way too much money from fake news.
Yeah, exactly.
Fox News.
Yeah. All right, cool. So the next thing I'm going to do is, so we're going to look into arguments and, well, how to make premises and conclusions. So the first thing we need to do is, it's very important in logic and reasoning in general,
yes,
we have to define terms very precisely, because we have to know exactly what we're talking about. So I found one definition of argument.
And if you're, there you go.
There we go. So the definition I found is, in logic and philosophy, an argument is a series of statements that present reasons for a conclusion. The reasons are often called premises, and they lead to a conclusion. An argument may be considered valid or invalid, and this stuff we'll look into in later episodes. It's a bit complicated, but just kind of memorize certain words for now. So it can be valid or invalid, and sound or unsound, depending on the given premises. But a good argument will always try to be both valid and sound, meaning that it makes logical sense and all of the given premises are true. Well, that's kind of the ultimate goal. I mean,
yeah, exactly. Yeah,
trying to do a good argument. Of course, you want it to be true. Why would?
Yeah,
you?
Exactly. But it also depends on who you're having the argument against.
Yes.
And depending on how smart or intelligent they are. Now, if you're talking about somebody who's both parties are smart and intelligent, then yes, both parties would bring valid and sound meaning to it. But if you're talking to somebody who's
challenged,
yeah, okay, there you go. I was trying to look at the word. I'm like, okay, what should I say? Yeah, somebody, well, not really like mentally challenged.
Well, no,
but you're talking to somebody who's just, you know, they're not all there. You know, maybe like a Donald Trump.
Deficient.
Yes. then you might get, you know, some very childish, you know, things back like,
Yeah, that's right.
So that's one thing. And then you might be very intelligent and talk, and you're just like, what? What did you just say? I don't understand. You can't even read what you just wrote. You know, they'll write like, you know, some, you know, they'll use like a lot of slang terms. But normally what I like to do is I like to use the literal meaning of it. Yes. Like they're like, oh, you know, you're just jelly. I'm like, really?
Yeah.
They'll use the literal meaning of jelly.
Yeah.
You know, so...
All right, so just remember that, so the most important parts are, okay, let's probably switch that on. All right, that went
away.
There you
go.
So, yeah, the most important part to remember is that, so these are kind of keywords, valid, invalid, sound, unsound, and we'll look at that in later episodes. Okay, so now we need to figure out how we can spot an argument. And here you have to remember that some sentences are just not arguments. For example, if I say it's raining today, well, that's not an argument. I mean,
exactly.
What can you say?
It's a statement.
It's a statement.
Yeah. I mean, unless it's not really raining, you know.
That's right.
You know, and you say it's raining outside, you're like, wait, I said, no, it's not.
Yeah. So in order to make it into an argument even, you have to place what's called premise markers and conclusion markers. Yeah. And so some examples here, premise markers, because, since, as indicated by, there's other words, okay? This is just some of them, the most common perhaps. And well, you can say it's raining today because the moisture in the air is high.
Yeah.
Well, then you have an argument. And the conclusion markers, therefore, thus, so, hence. Again, this is just some, there are more. We'll probably find more as we look in the arguments later on. Okay, so the first example is, you have to remember, and this is very important, is that sometimes it's very possible for the premises to be true, but the conclusion to be false. So here's one example. I have two apples. Sandy gives me two apples. In conclusion, I have five apples. Well, wait a second. That's just not correct, right? I mean, but that's what I'm saying. It's just an example, but it's just to show that you can have true premises, but unfortunately, a false conclusion.
Yeah.
By example two, we have a bit more complex, but same situation. Just consider this scenario. Premise one: I just woke up. Premise two: my wife has been at work for many hours. Number three, I live with my wife and nobody else. And premise four, there are fresh wet footprints on the floor. And the conclusion, someone broke in. Well, we don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
We don't know. And then, of course, later you look into some other room and, oh, well, your wife is actually home early for whatever reason and she just took a shower. So,
yeah.
It is possible for the premises to make logical sense, and yet the conclusion.
Or they may also have a dog or a cat, you know. So
yeah,
or multitude of other animals. You know, people have more than just cats and dogs.
Yes,
and that. you know, some people even have tigers.
Yeah, that's true.
It's like, why would you do that? But all right, whatever.
Yeah,
you know, but yeah, it could possibly be the reason. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
But it's too ambiguous. We cannot say for sure that.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to trust the person, basically, that he's telling the truth for some reason.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, let's continue. So now we have another one, and this is an example of a good argument. So this is very simple. All men are mortal, premise one. And premise two, Charles Darwin is a man. So in conclusion, Charles Darwin is mortal.
Yeah, that's perfect. That's perfect.
Makes sense.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? So premises are true, conclusion is true. So this would be what's called a valid and sound argument, because the premises are true and the whole thing makes sense. All right, let's continue. So example four. This is kind of a pet topic of mine, so climate change.
Yes.
All right, so here we have CO2 is a greenhouse gas. Premise two, yes. Methane is a greenhouse gas. Premise three, greenhouse gases trap some of the heat going out into space, not all. And premise four, average temperatures go up if heat cannot escape. All right, and in conclusion, average temperatures are going up. We can see that.
Yes.
There is evidence.
Exactly.
Every year is the hottest on record.
Yep.
It just keeps going. The trend continues. So again, this is a good argument. Of course, if you are an oil executive, then this conclusion is not good for you.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of people that deny climate change.
Yeah.
I mean, like, really, I mean, you're really denying climate change? I mean, just...
Yeah. Well, because there is snow over there.
Of course. Of course. You know, there's snow in Alaska, yes.
Yeah.
Of course. Aha, that's Sarah Palin.
Yeah.
Thing, yeah.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, look, you know, there's snow there. See? And what, even a two-year-old can tell you there's no climate change.
Yeah, just wait.
Yeah, that's another thing I'm fearing about. It's just like, eventually, it's going to happen. The Earth is going to be, it's going to be done if we don't do something about it.
Yeah, that's right.
It's, you know, but then you have all the people lining their pockets, big oil companies lining them. Some money, you know, to trick the American people and trick everybody,
yeah,
you know?
That's right. And there's also another separate argument here that can be made. Let's say you actually are denying that, you know, the greenhouse gases trap the heat and all that. Mm-hmm. But you can't deny that those coal plants are very dirty. They make pollution, okay?
Yes.
So even if you deny the greenhouse gas aspect of it, you cannot deny that the pollution is there. You can see that. You can see that black smoke or from exhaust of cars, right? You can see that.
Yeah.
So... at least, wouldn't that be in your best interest to do something about that? I mean, just to reduce pollution?
Yeah, I mean, look at China. I
exactly.
Mean, China's a fine example of pollution overrunning it.
Yes.
You know?
Well, Beijing, at least.
Yeah, Beijing. Yeah. Not all China.
Yeah, because they're actually doing a lot of stuff there to combat it.
Yeah.
I mean, I took a climate change course online, and I had to do a lot of research into what other countries are doing.
Oh, okay.
Actually, China is doing quite a lot. It's just, I think that if you watch the media, they always go to Beijing, so it's like that's the only image you always have. So.
I knew all of China wasn't like that, but I'm just using that as an example.
Yeah,
you can literally cut the air with a knife.
Yes.
You know, we always use that as an expression, but it's literal over there.
Yeah. That's creepy.
Yeah, it's crazy.
All right. And so the last thing, I call it a case study, but it's not really. I infiltrated a couple of Facebook Christian pages on using a fake account just to see what they're talking about. And usually it's usually something crazy.
Yeah, like of course.
Some kind of picture posted type amen if you support.
Yeah,
and then you get like a huge list like amen.
Yeah.
It's like...
yes, like that's gonna do anything.
Yeah.
Oh, I could make sure. Oh, little Billy's sick here. If we get 100 likes, we can make him all better.
Yeah.
Jesus
yeah.
will hear us.
Yeah.
Right, Jabus.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So this is Well, I'll show you the argument, then I'll describe. So, okay, let's just read it and then we'll discuss it, I guess. Need all my fellow prayer warriors, I like that, to pray hard for my coworker and girlfriend Sharon McCulley. She is with the guys she's been with for 18 years, the father of her kids. They're not. Okay, I have to stop it right here. I'm sorry. I cannot take people seriously if they cannot spell properly. So there's already two mistakes in the first three lines.
So, come on, were you expecting anything better here? No. Come on now.
But the first thing we have to do is we have to clean it up. So I already did, and here we go. This is a bit better. Okay, so need all my fellow prayer warriors to pray hard for my coworker and girlfriend, Sharon McCulley. She's with a guy she's been with for 18 years, the father of her kids. They're not legally married, but she's mentally, emotionally, and verbally abused by him. I think she's scared to leave him because of that. She told me he'd come looking for her if she tried leaving. I pray that God would intervene and through some way, I like that, save her. I have a few close friends praying for her, but I need a lot of prayers to go out to God from as many people as possible. Wow.
Yeah.
I actually commented on that and I said, if this is really, I mean, we don't know, okay? Maybe this person just like had nothing to do and just made up this whole story, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but let's say it's true.
Yeah, it does.
It's plausible.
Yeah, it's very possible, yes.
So,
a lot of people scared to leave their significant other, like, you know. Yeah. What's that? I can't even think what that's called. Where basically somebody is kidnapped and they're basically... Yeah. Stockholm syndrome.
Oh yeah, that's right.
That's what I was trying to think of the name. I was like, Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah, that's the one.
And people, you know, they basically get stuck there, and they want to leave, but they don't want to leave. Yeah. Like there's, you know.
So I actually commented on this post. I kind of knew the reaction I would get, but basically what I said is I said, okay, if this is really the case, then I think you should probably consider getting something like a restraining order. Well, that would be the first step anyway.
Yes.
I mean, that's the basic protection.
Yeah.
And of course, somebody replied, well, it doesn't always work. Okay, yeah, it's true. It doesn't always work, but a prayer to God never works. So don't get me started. I mean...
Yes.
It's true. My solution is not ideal, but their solution is not a solution at all. So
you can easily just, you know, depending on how bad it is, I mean, she can even be put in a witness protection program.
That's true,
you know,
yeah.
And they can move her to somewhere else, give her a complete new identity.
Yeah.
And if it so comes to it, have, you know, depending on how bad it is, I mean, you can have police protection.
Yeah.
You know, have home security, get a home security system.
Yeah.
You know. So yes, it is. That's more possible than praying to God.
Exactly.
You know, that's a little more, you know, better idea. Anything's a better idea.
Yeah, yeah, you know? Definitely. So this is what we're gonna do on the show quite often. We're gonna show you a kind of paragraph, I suppose, a paragraph containing many keywords, and later we have to break it down. So I already did it for you, but just bear with me for a second. So the way it works is, example 5, you have to break it down into basically premises and a conclusion later. And this is not the only way to do this. This is just an example for people to look at and just a template if you want.
Yeah.
So premise 1, we don't know the name of the guy. So yeah. I just called him Mr. X. Mr. X and Sharon are together. Premise 2, Mr. X and Sharon have kids. Premise 3, Mr. X abuses Sharon mentally, emotionally, and verbally. Premise 4, Sharon wants to get away, but Mr. X threatens to find her. All right, and so again, in their conclusion, more people need to pray for her. Right? Well, that's what we just saw.
I know, right? that doesn't make sense. Like,
no. Wait,
you know, and even prayer, that's... It's not gonna work, you know.
No.
It's you're
not
going backwards, you know. It's not gonna take you forwards, you know. You need to do something about it, you know. You can't just sit by and idle and like go twiddle your thumbs and say, oh well, I'm just gonna pray to God about it, you know.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna sit right here. Hopefully God will bring me that $1 million,
that's right.
You know.
But he can turn into a cloud of fire.
Of course, so. of course. And show you magic tricks.
That's right. So just very quickly, it is possible also to break a premise into kind of two separate conclusions. So if you remember in the paragraph, it said because the guy is going to find her. So you can actually break this whole thing into a separate conclusion. So you would draw a line here and you put the three dots here. That's the kind of universal conclusion marker. And you would put the conclusion to this part only here. And then under that, so basically here, I would put like an X, that would go there. So you kind of stack them up, and that's the way it works. So we'll explore that more in later episodes, but I just wanted to do an intro today and show people how it works, because a lot of people, I find that a lot of people, when they start to make an argument, it's just not an argument at all. So, you know, I took a very difficult online course on logic and reason. I'm proud to say I got 95%.
Wow.
Which is with distinction. And it was really hard. It was not exciting most of the time. Well, yeah. It's not, okay?
Of course. But
I did learn a lot of things, and of course, fallacies. We'll look into that also later. Let's start with this one, and then we'll discuss.
Okay, this video is titled "The Atheist Delusion." Obviously, it's a riff on Dawkins' book, "The God Delusion." Atheists have a real problem. Atheists don't have a leg to stand on. They don't have any evidence for their belief.
All right.
Okay, so...
All right, so we just got done watching that one.
Yep. So the first part that I think needs addressing is atheism is not a belief, okay?
Exactly.
This is the first confusion that he makes. How is a lack of belief suddenly a belief? I don't understand.
Yeah, exactly.
So to try and squirm out of this problem, what they do is they exist now with a delusion. They call themselves... atheist agnostics or agnostic atheists. And this is a real strange thing to call themselves, because the classic definition of an atheist is somebody who says God does not exist. It's a pretty definitive statement. It's a statement that closes all doors to the possibility that God exists. Now, on the other hand, you have them claiming agnosticism. Well, agnosticism is the possibility that God may exist. So when they claim that they have an agnostic atheistic belief or an atheistic agnostic belief, what they're claiming is God does not exist, but on the other hand, maybe he does. It's kind of like saying this watch does not exist. Closed door, shut case. On the other hand, maybe it does.
He defines atheism and agnosticism, but I don't think he defines them very well.
So, no.
Atheism means that basically we reject the theistic claim that a deity or deities exist. That's
exactly
all. Mm-hmm. There's nothing more to it. There's nothing less to it.
Yep.
Agnosticism atheism is a kind of, it's a position of belief, yes, but it's not a belief.
Yeah, it's not a belief. It's not a religion, you know, it's not.
Yeah, and we don't have any,
Yeah, exactly. You're not going to see us going to church on Sunday. There's no atheist church.
Well, there are, actually.
Oh, you're right. No, yeah, you're right.
But it's very kind of just talking.
Yeah, exactly. It's just sitting down talking to one another. You know, it's kind of like I wouldn't say it's a church. It's more like a gathering of people. You know, it's not really a church. You know, you're not going there to you know, we're like, all right, turn to page number 300 of Richard Dawkins, The God Delusion.
Right. Yeah.
All right, stand up for this helm. All praise Charles Darwin. Da, 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 you know.
Yeah.
So, but as far as agnosticism, you know, he's kind of, you know, didn't really explain it very well. It's, you know, when it comes to being, you know, like you talk atheist, agnostic, over there, right? It's basically, okay, there's no actual evidence or proof for there being, you know, a God or anything of that nature. So, but why completely just rule it out? I mean, if there's circumstantial evidence beyond a shadow of a doubt that proves it, then okay.
In the video, he kind of really puts them at polar opposites.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is possible to be both, of course.
Yeah, exactly. He's just like, oh, atheist delusion.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, He likes to repeat the same things in his videos.
I've noticed that with a lot of, you watch a lot of the Christian videos, they tend to repeat themselves over and over and over and over again.
I think, you know why? I think it's because in the Bible, if you read certain things, they actually do just repeat the same paragraph like three times or something.
Yeah.
Just, even sometimes it's worded the exact same way, just like a repetition.
Yeah.
It's weird, but...
Yeah, they got to fill up the pages, right?
Yeah, that's right.
They
got
to fill them up, so, you know, you got to do something.
Well, the thicker it is, the more impressive... I don't know how it works. I mean, the thicker it is, the more impressive it is to people. I guess.
I don't know.
They've been busted. They have no evidence to support that God doesn't exist. And the truth is, atheists don't exist.
Atheists were busted. Oh, my God, we're busted.
Oh,
no.
He got us, man. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Are we going to do now?
Oh, man, we got busted by some dude with the watch. Oh, watch doesn't. Oh, the watch doesn't. See, I can believe the watch doesn't exist because I don't have a watch.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
ha ha ha! Showed you.
So what he really talks about there is he's trying to make the case that proving a negative is possible, and I just want to explain that it's not. We can say that there is a teacup flying around the orbit of Pluto somewhere, and it's really there. It's really there. I'm telling you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't have to prove it.
Yep, exactly.
I just say it. It's there. It's really there. Mm-hmm. I know the shape of it.
Like leprechauns.
Yeah.
Leprechauns, of course.
Mm-hmm. Or we can say that right now there is between me and James, there is a big red Starbucks cup on the desk.
Yeah, exactly.
Now prove it's not there.
Exactly. Exactly. Don't you see it? It's right here.
Yeah.
Come on.
Take a sip.
some good coffee.
Yeah.
Not my favorite, but, you know, it'll do. It'll do.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's okay.
All right. Well, I think, I don't know, for me, that's all I have to say in the video. Do you have any extra points on that one, or?
Not really, no.
Okay.
You know, he's, and especially that comment section, though.
That's funny. Actually, if you do go into his comment section, it's like, I think the very first comment right now is, this guy is dumb. All right, let's move on and then into his next point.
Okay, today we're going to talk about the one question that all atheists fear, or at the very least, they really hate to try and answer this question. I've been debating, going back and forth with atheists for just over a year now.
I like how he says he was debating with atheists. How can you debate with somebody when you have zero debating skills?
And they always pose this question, and the question is, give me the evidence that Christianity is true, that Jesus is God, things of that nature. So I'll thinking they're honest, I'm going to go down the evidence and I'll cite the scientific evidence, the historical evidence, the archaeological evidence, third-party evidence, fulfilled prophetic evidence, statistical probabilities. I'll cite the eyewitness accounts of over 500 people that saw the events. 25,000 pieces of parchments and documents that are original and show that the text has never been altered. I mean, I go through mountains and mountains of evidence, only to have them say at the end, that doesn't really count. That's not really evidence. You still don't have any proof that God exists, and you certainly don't have any proof that Jesus is God. Well, the first time I heard that, it was pretty stunning.
He lists the evidence, his evidence, of course.
Yeah, source.
So, like, the 500 people, the eyewitnesses, who are they? Why would you... that was, as far as I know, that was completely disproven anyway. This is not... Yeah. It's nothing. It was all made up, as far as I know. He says there's evidence of Jesus. Okay, if you actually watch our very last, this is the last show, but the one before, so the Christmas special, we did almost, we talked for about half an hour, I think, about the evidence why Jesus didn't exist at all. The records do not add up. There is too many inconsistencies. If you look at Paul, he doesn't mention that at all. The texts were, of course, altered many times. There are passages that were inserted just to kind of satisfy the myth itself. But if somebody, again, I will repeat the same thing I repeated last time. if somebody as miraculous as Jesus really existed, and I mean, he could, I don't know, walk on water and turn water into water wine. And make some kind of food
somehow. Oh, yeah, made, what is it, the, he fed the 1,000 people with, like, I think two loaves of bread. That's and, right. Like, some, like, two or three fish or something. Like, I fed, like, thousands of people with it, supposedly.
He was, like, dividing them or something. Okay, if that really occurred, wouldn't you think that this would be recorded somewhere, like in external records, but you do not find any of that?
Exactly.
Okay, then he says the text has never been altered. Well, that's absolute horse shit.
I came on the one question that all atheists fear, no atheist can answer, by accident. Because one day I was so flustered, I said, okay, show me the evidence you have to prove that God does not exist. And I got an answer like this. It was a blank stare. They don't have evidence that God doesn't exist. I mean, I thought that was interesting and a little bit poetic.
Poetic, yeah.
I like so that. So we just got done watching the stand-up comedian.
That's right, yeah. The one thing he seems to completely forget is that we have read the book. Well, not all of us, but most of us have read the book. We know what it's about.
Exactly.
We are atheists because we read it.
Exactly. We actually looked into logic and reason and just, we didn't find the evidence there. Yeah. I mean, but if you really do research into history and everything like that and look at other things, you'll see that even like Muhammad's story, you know, from Islam, is basically the same story as Jesus. Yeah, yeah. There's also about three or four other ones that exact same story.
Yeah.
Exact, almost down to a T. A couple of them are almost down to a T, and they were told long before the supposed time of Jesus was there. Yeah.
So he says, prove God does not exist. Okay, we just covered that. You're proving the negative.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the atheist's response is silence. Well, yeah, what do you expect? I mean, you cannot prove a negative. This was demonstrated many, many times. You know,
it's like okay, you see this awesome deal on the car, and you're like, oh, cool, I'm gonna go in there and get it, right? And then you go in there, and the guy was like, going there, okay, now here you go, here's this piece of paper. It's like, well, let me see the car. You know, I want to see this car. You know, I want to test drive it. Of course, that's what you're gonna do if you have a car or any type of big appliance. Like there, sure, like you buy a TV, you see the TV model on sale. You see what the picture looks like, so you can look at different angles. Okay, cool. I like the way this. You can try it. You know. And or even, you know, an iPhone or a BlackBerry or whatever, you know, whatever device you want to in there. Yeah. And let's just say, oh, you got to go sign this contract, and you got to give me 10% of your money. Okay, but you have to have faith that the device exists.
Yes, that's correct. Well, it's like Bill Maher always says. I mean, how hard is it to sell an invisible product?
Exactly. That's pretty easy. Hello, hi. Would you like to buy this Starbucks coffee? I mean, come on now. It's from the show. Come on now.
Yeah.
You want to buy it?
I can autograph it.
Yeah. Oh, look at that. He can autograph it just for you. There you go.
Oh, wait. I have to use my imaginary pen.
Exactly. Hey, the cup's there. What are you signing? Oh, that's right. You're signing our other cup that's up there. Yeah, we have like
stacked up.
It's a huge stack of them. Yeah, yeah. Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there is. There's really there. You just have to believe in him.
Yes. You have to have faith.
Yes.
You have to have faith in the cup.
And you gotta send us 10% of your money too. Yeah. You forgot about that.
Oh, of course.
The atheist and his burden of proof. I'm frequently asked a question all the time to prove as a Christian that God exists. When this happens, and by the way, they always tell me it's you who make an extraordinary claim that God exists, so it's up to me as a Christian to prove that he exists. Well, that's no problem.
He is right that if you make a, you know, extraordinary claim, you need to give extraordinary evidence. So that's correct. But the thing that he's wrong on, of course, is that the atheists have to do that. By the way, this is a bit tricky because he says, he has a misconception about atheism. We do not say that God does not exist. We just reject the claim that you make. that God exists.
Exactly.
If we actually do say God does not exist, that's a definite position.
Yeah.
And we would somehow have to demonstrate that that is a reality. Yeah. But there's no atheists that says that. So that's ridiculous. The extraordinary claim, because we do not see a God in our everyday life. We do not go into a coffee shop and we look around and there's
God.
There's God. Okay, I also have to make clear here, the reason why the burden of proof exists is because if it doesn't exist, then anybody can just walk around and make any kind of crazy claim, don't have to prove it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And just get away with it.
Yeah.
This is the reason why it's there. And of course, this is come back to the scientific method. You have a claim and you have to give evidence for that claim, then you test the evidence.
Exactly.
And if it's like positive, then you know it's good. If it's negative, then you throw out the entire thing, or you change certain parameters and try again.
Yeah, but exactly. It's like with
it is not the Christian that makes the extraordinary claim. This is just a false charge that atheists have, because the Christian, just like the atheist, lives in God's creation. We breathe the air he gave us. We look at the stars, we look at the moons, we look at the earth and the oceans and everything he created. It's obvious there's a creator. Just as obvious as when you sit down in a chair, the chair had a creator.
He very falsely assumes, without evidence, that we live on God's creation.
Yeah.
And that everything around here is created by God, the moon, the water, the forest, the mountains. Well, okay, that's obviously an extremely biased view.
Yeah. Just like they always say, oh, look at the world around you.
Yeah.
The world's not a great place.
Yeah.
Not everywhere in the world. If the whole world was all nice and pretty and that nature, okay, and maybe there's no homeless, no famine, everybody's got a place to live and, fed and stuff of that nature, and, there's no wars and stuff like that, okay, fine, fine, whatever.
Still not evidence for God, though.
It's still, of course, it's not really evidence, but, at least it's a little bit stronger evidence towards it. But the world's it's not always a great place. Now, yes, there is beautiful parts of it. Now, yes, there is good parts of it.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it's not that great.
Too many inconsistencies, people dying from hunger, people dying from various diseases,
and then even in their own church, in the Catholic Church, with the preachers and them raping the little boys.
That's in
supposedly, a church is supposed to be God's house. Well, in your own house you have people raping children, getting raped. You have Catholic preachers coming up with child pornography on, that's church true. Computers.
Yeah.
And then there was one that stood there and said, like, oh, I didn't know child pornography was illegal.
Oh, yeah, I saw that one. Yeah.
I was like, are you serious? You don't know. Are you, what? And then they'll do cover-ups also. They'll just kind of sweep it under the rug.
Yeah, yeah.
They'll be like, oh, we got to move this guy to over here.
Some other country sometime.
This other state, so they don't know him. And they don't know that he's raped little boys and has allegations. We'll just put him over there and everything's hunky-dory.
I look at the world and I just see nature. That's all.
Yeah.
And it's just mechanical, biological processes.
If you think everything has to come from something, so that means God must come from something.
Something,
so did a super God create that God?
Yeah.
And did the super mega ultra God create the mega God?
Yeah,
and then you can go on and on and on, the super mega ultra death Christ 3000, it's just endless.
What the thing they say, though, in that case is that, they cheat in that case.
Yeah,
they
of course.
Say, well, but he exists outside of that, realm.
Of course.
All right.
Fun. It's definitely fun. I'd definitely like to come back again.
Sure.
It'd be cool.
Yeah, for sure. All right, cool. Thanks for watching. The next episode will be probably at the end of March somewhere. We're going to change a little bit. I want to do a video that kind of touches upon conspiracy theories and this whole thing that, corporations are everywhere. And just bear in mind, next show you might want to prepare your tinfoil hat.
Yeah.
Get it ready.
Yeah.
All right, so see you next time.
Yep. Take care.